All right, welcome to the second hour of our prime time broadcast. This is Clarity Ross for the Christ Clarity channel, providing you the real prime time broadcast, if I can say these things. The other stuff is fake. Okay, why? Because it doesn't serve what you really want at all. It serves what you think you want, not what you really want. This broadcast is focused on providing you what you really want, or at least reminding you of what you really want. Okay. So I've worked on my little studio here for this broadcast. Somehow it just came together, and looks pretty nice. In the first hour of this broadcast, we spoke about consent, how you've never consented to any of this, really. Because it's consent under false pretenses. How can you consent to the impossible? How is that possible? You cannot. You say, yes, I consent to trying to accomplish the impossible. There's no real consent because the impossible can never be accomplished. So how can there be any real consent? It's not. It's only temporary consent. Temporary up to the point where you realize it's futile. When you realize it's futile, you realize there was no real consent in the first place. So this is real advice, real programming, real directional push to recognize this, because we're trapped in a situation where we think we're supposed to honor commitments and promises and all this stuff that was derived from us under false pretenses, underlined, and we think that we're trying to, we'll show them what we're people of our word, you know, we'll keep our word. That doesn't work. That's exactly what they want you to think. We'll keep our word to remain enslaved to them. Our word that we would that we consented to what they asked of us was extricated from us, extracted from us under lies, deceptions, false promises, self-delusion, and ultimately under the notion that we can change reality, which is impossible. So in no way or any of the promises we made, just, righteous, true, binding promises at all. Because we cannot, they were impossible to fulfill in the first place. You see? So literally, we can be free of all those, of the direction that those promises push us in. We can be free of that direction. We can go in a different direction. We can turn it around. And we will turn it around. That's the whole purpose of this programming. The real prime time here is to provide you, we're under the impression there's no alternative. I always say that. I look and say, there's no alternative. Well, here's an alternative. There is an alternative. This is being presented as an alternative so that you can't, don't despair, and you say, well, there's just nothing anywhere. No chance. I got no chance. Might as well just watch this junk, you know. Well, it's not true. Here is an alternative, so make use of the alternative if you want to watch anything. You know, we're pretty much in the habit, a lot of us, of you know, filling up our evenings, you know, in some way like that. So here we go. Here we go, here we go. Welcome everybody to the second hour of this initial prime time pilot, as it were. And we're providing this to you. Maybe it'll be posted by about 8 o'clock our time, which is 11 p.m. East Coast time, which is, I guess, still prime time when you're watching the news or when you're watching the late night shows, etc. I'll have some real late night show for you. Okay, we might even have some comedy. We'll find out what's really humorous. Comedy of the world is not humorous. It's like they're saying, okay, everybody, let's laugh as we march into slavery and bondage and oppression. Let's all yuck it up, you know. Isn't this fun? Aren't we having fun? Aren't those people who aren't doing that, aren't those people losers, you know, terrible losers? And aren't we great? And, yeah, let's laugh about that. Yeah, I don't find it funny at all. I don't find those late night comedians funny in the slightest bit. I find it repugnant, you know. There's no humor there. There's no humor at all. Really sick. We're not having fun as we march into bondage. We're not having any fun. And I guess we think that somehow we're being loyal to something, a promise we made, as if that loyalty is going to pay off. It's not going to pay off. Loyalty to the devil, how does that pay off? Loyalty to the etheric parasites, how does that pay off for us? How does it pay off? It doesn't. Pays off in suffering. That's how it pays off. And that's not what we really want. And we think that they tell us the suffering is, it will eventuate in some great breakthrough. No, it won't. Not that type of suffering. The examination of suffering results in a great breakthrough, because you realize that's not what you really want. And that's the great breakthrough. So, you know, you can, in that respect, but that's not the way that it's, you know, geared towards. It's not geared towards that. It's not geared toward that realization. This is geared to that realization, because we've been through suffering, and we realize that's not what we really want. This ridiculous attempt to accomplish the impossible is not what we really want. This attempt to change reality, which is impossible, that's not what we really want. It was just something that we wanted to have a fling with, you know. A crazy fling. Well, it's been a crazy fling. Really crazy. You know, you talk about, you know, marrying a psycho, as it were. Well, there you go. Right on cue. Someone shouted going down the street, right on cue. Marrying a psycho. Well, trying to change reality is like marrying a complete psycho. You know, it's horrible. Horrible, horrible, horrible. And you think that you can never get out of it. Never get out of it. But you absolutely can. Absolutely can get out of it. So, here we don't have to fill every minute of the situation with fluff. And we can pace ourselves. We can spend some moments quietly. I adjust the controls a little bit just to give different looks, you know. And we don't have any sophisticated graphics, you know, and text and all that stuff, but who needs that, really? What we want here is sophisticated ideas, sophisticated clarifications, sophisticated focus. That's what we want. We want that to be sophisticated. We don't need all these flying logos and trumpets and all the stuff like that, that trumpeting, you know, here we go, dun 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 dun. It's like there's a proclamation coming down from the queen herself, you know, the way they play this music on all the various news shows and everything, you know, dun 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 dun. Hey, we have some very important news to impart to you. I say, okay, all right, I got my full attention. And then, you know, oh my gosh. Oh, you know, really? It's like, boy, we better watch, because the royalty wants us to watch, you know. Wants us to watch. And when we do watch, we regret it. So let's not keep regretting. Don't keep doing regretful things, you know. That's the problem, right? Try to start doing what you don't regret, which leads you to what you really want. Start doing that. And that will help you out a great deal. We're doing this outside. The studio is actually outside, if you can believe that. And we are just using the natural light. Natural light. And the sun is setting here. It's almost set, as a matter of fact. It's barely on the horizon right now. But it's a hot one today. But pleasant still. It's Bay Area hot, which is, what, 94? But dry, you know, and doesn't. It's not bad at all. No trouble. So very nice to be out here this evening with you. And take a, stretch, relax, breathe, calm down, realize you're not missing anything if you're not watching prime time. You're not missing anything. I know that the Olympics are going on and people are thinking like, I gotta watch the Olympics because there's something really, incredible is gonna take place. Somebody's gonna run real fast, Okay. Really? Think about that. Running really fast is something like incredible for us, like wow, that is like something to idolize, something to be amazed about, something to spend our time talking about. Oh wow, someone ran fast. What kind of physicality is worth paying attention to? Who cares? Somebody jumped up in the air. Who cares? We're in desperate times. We are under full-on assault. Psychic, etheric assault. To the extent of, you talk about the battles in the Middle Eastern areas and those areas, just the full-on assaults. I mean, that's nothing compared to the full-on assault that the whole planet is under, especially the United States of America, by these psychic vampires and etheric parasites. That is a tremendous assault taking place, all out. Just you talk about firepower, you talk about bombardment, you talk about an assault. The assault that's going on there makes a war here look like a picnic. Really, it's a vicious assault. I mean, you say what are the weapons? How about starting with the movies? Look at all the movies that are being released. Right there, psychic steroids. Those are the weapons that are being used. And you're hit with those. You're not hit physically. You're hit. Your subtle bodies are hit. Okay. Your emotional nervous system is hit, your subtle bodies are hit, and you are, severely wounded, as it were, by those weapons they're using. And so that's why I say, don't watch any movies. Do not. I don't care what they are, because they'll throw trailers in there, right? They'll throw advertisements, they'll throw trailers, they'll throw all sorts of subliminal stuff. And they'll get you one way or the other. Or they'll get you to let your guard down and say, well, that wasn't so bad. Maybe I'll go see another one. Before you know it, you're in a movie and it's, like, oh my gosh, these, robotic monsters are coming for you, and just in 3D, and they're surrounding you. It's just nasty, nasty stuff. So those are part of the weaponry they use. The shock events in the world are also part of it. And just a culture of incivility is part of it. Culture of lying, of distorting, of having no rules to play by, that you see in the political arena, you see in the social activism arena, just no rules anywhere, on all sides. It's those who play by the rules, those who try to maintain civility, they're getting crushed. Because it's how do you compete against someone who doesn't play by the rules, who cheats, makes up their own rules, and could care less about any sort of fairness at all. No sportsmanship, no fairness, don't play by any rules, ruthless, will do anything. How do you withstand that, is the question, and the answer is, you don't, as far as this world is concerned. But, it's a pity, though, those who would sell their soul to gain this world, as it were. What a pity. What a pity. All they're doing is gaining enslavement, which isn't any gain at all. And they think, everybody's trying to be the, get the position of overseer. On the plantation, you have the slaves, you have the overseer, you have overseers. And different, levels of privilege, as it were. And so everybody is desperately, trying. trying to get some sort of status, some sort of perk, some sort of privilege. And they say, you know, yes, master, we will do whatever you want us to do. Just, you know, go easy on us, you know. And so many have decided, yeah, you know, they'll sell everybody out just so that, you know, it'll go easy for them, a little easier for them. Which is, you know, it's not right. It's just, it's buying into insanity. That's what it is. Because there is a way out. There is a way to freedom. Passover principle is existence is loss-based. Okay? Its purpose is to bring about loss. Because changing reality means to bring about loss. We keep thinking, oh, we can change part of it or make it better, etc. No, reality is what it is. It's perfect. It's flawless. It will always be that way. And we would have to lose reality. In other words, we no longer have it. It's gone. We lost it. We have to create a fantasy of loss. And ultimately, we believe by destroying this fantasy, destroying itself, devouring itself. You know, the symbol of existence is the snake, the Ouroboros, the snake that is devouring its own tail. That's existence. Existence is ceaselessly devouring itself. And the ultimate premise of this, the plausible premise, is that if existence can completely annihilate itself, then that will have changed reality. Which is plausibly true. See, that is a truth within a plausible impossibility. Is it if, but it cannot. So if and then the then can never happen. You see how that's a trick, though? If we only look at the then and then, we deceive ourselves. If existence, which is a symbolic imagination of mind, could completely destroy itself, then it would change reality. Actually, it would annihilate reality, because reality is one. There's no parts to reality. It's one. So if we change it, we'd get rid of all of it, because it is cannot be fragmented or changed. So basically, we'd have to completely wipe it out. It'd all have to disappear entirely. We cannot have a changed reality. Ultimately, we can only have no reality. Either we have reality or we have no reality. So we're trying to, we think we're trying to change it, but what we're trying to do is get rid of all of it. And existence tries to destroy itself, annihilate itself, thinking that that would mean, if it was possible, it would mean that which is choosing to experience existence, that is holding existence, that is entertaining this idea of changing reality, that which is holding the idea would also have to be annihilated. You see? Because you cannot have effects without a cause. And if you have no effects, you have no cause. You have no cause. But what I found out, a great discovery really, is so important, is that this annihilation is actually a symbolic, it's only symbolic, total chaos. It symbolizes total chaos. But the one who is trying to annihilate existence is still there, simply holding. Now they're just experiencing total chaos, symbolically, total chaos, energy, energetic total chaos. Energy is symbolic. It's this energetic total chaos. I experienced it. I said, oh my gosh, okay. That's what existence is after, but it doesn't work. It doesn't work. Because I still remain. I was aware of it. I said, oh, I'm just experiencing this. The one who's experiencing it is the same. But then I said, whoa, I don't want that. No way. It's impossible to want that, to really want it. Cannot. And we were not created to want that. So we don't really want it. And I realized that for sure. I don't really want that. And so existence cannot totally annihilate itself. It can only get to the point of total energetic chaos. That's it. That's as far as it can go. As far as it can go. And then at that point, it has to start dreaming something other than that total chaos. And it just can keep going around in circles, but it can't go any further than that. And so from that fact, can't go any further than that, then you cannot annihilate the one who is entertaining this idea. You cannot do it. You can get it to reject the idea, but that's not annihilating the one who is choosing the idea. Spirit chooses ideas. Mind presents ideas. And so if you don't like the effect of an idea, you simply choose another idea. That doesn't mean that by setting down one idea, picking up another, that doesn't mean the one who's choosing and experiencing ideas is annihilated. Not at all. Not at all. So our plan to change reality doesn't work. Cannot work. Will never work. There is no plan to accomplish this. None. None. So working on it is wasted time. It's wasted time. And that's why we're here watching this video, because we don't want to keep working on it. You're watching something else, like, you know, movies, television, whatever. You know, chances are you're working on a plan to accomplish the purpose of existence, even though you may deny the purpose is to annihilate itself. You know, most of us are not aware of that. We deny it. We deny it. We say, no, that's not possible. How could we possibly be doing that? But it is true. That is what existence is all about. So working on that is a waste of time. Therefore, work on seeing that as a waste. It is a waste of time. That's what we do. We work on seeing it's a waste of time. We're wasting our time with working on the purpose of existence by enslaving ourselves. You know, the etheric parasites present this powerful utopian ideal to us, and we think, hey, maybe if we serve them long enough, they'll lift us up into their utopia. Or maybe if we serve them loyally enough, we will ourselves get to be lifted up into that utopia. You know, yeah. But that utopia is crumbling and falling apart and requires the most vicious type of tactics to try and maintain it. And it's not a utopia at all. It's a nightmare. It's a place where we have what we think we want, okay, but nothing that we really want. And just getting everything we think we want, it's not the answer. Not the answer at all. I can tell you that for sure. It's not the answer. You're going to be like, oh my gosh, I need a little more and a little more and a little more. So you go down that path, you become a tyrant. You become a tyrant. You're willing to oppress. You're willing to oppress others. You're willing to do anything just to get a little more. You're willing to do anything just to go out shopping, get a new wardrobe, get a new whatever, okay? Get more status, get more power, get more control, get the latest, the newest, the best. Willing to do anything, willing to sell out no matter what. Because you think, the problem is you think you're almost there. See, you always think you're almost there. Therefore, you say, well, yeah, I'm gonna sell out and do something terrible, but I'll only do it once because I'm almost there and it's justified because this will then get me there and then I'll be able to make amends. So that's what happens. You know, for those who've been led down this path into what we call great wickedness or great insanity, they're aligned with great insanity. It's because they always thought they were almost there. And they just said, well, one more step isn't going to hurt, you know. And they then said, well, yeah, I'm going to compromise myself, etc. But this will be the last one, the only one, the last one, and we'll have to do it again, and it's going to be worth it. And what happens? It doesn't work, and then they feel, uh-oh, I need to do just one more, okay? And so it's step by step that how it works, is that people, we compromise ourselves step by step each time, believing it's the last time we're going to do this. And so you have, otherwise, you look at wonderful people, and my gosh, they've been, you know, destroyed. Their lives have been destroyed. They've gone down, you know, such a horrible path. And you wonder, how in the world could anybody, go down that path like that and end up in all that trouble? How could anyone end up in that trouble? It's exactly like that. They don't set out that way. They merely make one compromise, thinking that's the last one they're going to need to make, and after it'll succeed and give them everything they want. And then when they don't get everything they want, because that's what they think they want, and that doesn't satisfy, they say, oh my gosh, I need to make just one more compromise, and that should be the last. That doesn't work, then they say, oh, I gotta make one more, and then another, and then another. And before you know it, they've ended up going down that path for a long, long time, and they feel like totally trapped. You know, so, oh gosh, this is horrible. How did I get here? That's how it works. Everybody is vulnerable to that. Everyone is vulnerable in existence. Everyone, which is why forgiveness, again, is such a, so important. Forgiveness is so important because, you know, if you hadn't had the grace, you'd be down there too. And maybe you have been down there at some point. You know, everybody, you know, bottoms out at some point, sometime, somehow. And where they say, oh my gosh, what happened? What happened? How did that happen? I don't know. They say, I don't know. It's almost like we can hardly avoid it. It's like a moth to a flame because we're desperately trying to get what we want. What we think we want. We think we want it. So we think we want this. We think we want it. And believing that it'll make us happy. And it doesn't. It doesn't. It doesn't, because it's not what we really want. And then we get willing to just do anything. Just do anything. Say anything. Do anything. Whatever it takes just to get a little more power. Just to get a little more control, right? Just to get a little more money. Just to get a little more status. And the more you get, the more you're willing to do just a little more to get a little more. The more you're willing to compromise yourself to get even more. So they say power corrupts, and absolute power corrupts absolutely, which is very true. The higher you get on that path, on that, the more you're willing to sell out more and more and more, because you think you look at the power you have and you say, wow, I can't possibly be very far away from really being happy. It's not possible. You know, I'm at the pinnacle. I've got everything, all this power. It must only be just a little tiny step away. So what the heck, you know, why don't we pass this decree that everybody should lose all their freedom? And you think, well, I'll be so happy, then I'll be able to rescind the decree. Right? Say, guess what, folks? It was just temporary. But it doesn't work, and so it's not temporary. They add another and another. So we lose our freedom, and bit by bit, as society gets away from the real path that leads to escape, that leads to salvation, and they are chasing after what they think they want instead of what they really want. See, it's all important in our position here on this planet. It's all important to be able to distinguish between what we want and what we really want. Without that distinction, without our awareness of that distinction, we are completely vulnerable to being led down the worst paths, terrible paths. And it's very tricky, because even, you know, what we think we want is presented to us in as if it seems like what we really want too. I mean, and sometimes it's hard to determine. You know, you have to work at it. You really have to work at it. I've been deceived. Even though I'm a tireless worker, you know, I was deceived too. And still recovering from that. Still recovering. Because the deception has no shame. No shame. Deception will tell you anything you want to hear, just so you are willing to buy in and pursue what you think you want. And thereby ensnare yourself more and more and more. And become vulnerable to those who would profit from your ensnarement and misery. And existence is a slave-based situation. It's an exploit. It's based on exploitation. Its purpose is to destroy itself. And to do that, it exploits itself in every way possible. It's ruthless. It is without mercy. And you need to have mercy on yourself. Don't expect existence to have mercy on you, because it won't. It will not. It can't give you what you really want. Existence can never give you what you really want. you're not. There's no way, no how, that it can ever do this. I know people with garages full of the most exotic, expensive cars imaginable. 3, 4, some have 12, 15. They have huge areas. They have all these incredibly cars that some people, just die for. Are they happy? Are they have? No. They want, they want more. They want more. They want more. It's never enough. It is never enough. Whatever we get in this world is never enough. Never. And even trying to give up the world is still not enough. We have to get what we really want. It is not a matter of only saying, well, I know I can't get what I want in existence. Because we're still left in limbo at that point. We don't want to be left in limbo. We want to get what we really want. So it's super important to take that step, to pursue that step of finding out what we really want. And so that is my strong point, is talking about that and clarifying it. And what we really want is, again, a loss-free experience where we're not experiencing any loss. Nothing that we're experiencing is being lost to us. And we want a situation where we're not vulnerable, and nothing that we're experiencing is vulnerable. And we want a situation where we're carefree, we're not feel like we need to protect or defend ourselves. And we want a situation where there's no fear, okay? Only feeling of perfect carefreeness. We want a situation that feels completely fresh, not stale or old, but fresh, in the moment, fresh. And we want a situation that is beautiful, extremely beautiful, extremely serene and awe-inspiring. We want something that is glorious. We want the richness, tapestry. We want a flowingness. We want to know that we are eternal, and we want to know that nothing that we're experiencing can ever be harmed or changed or touched. This is all these things are what we really want, and we will never be satisfied until we experience what we really want, and existence can't give it to us. So there is something beyond existence, for sure. There most definitely is. Energy can't give it to us. Okay, let's go even further and say energy cannot give it to us, because energy is always energy is neutral. Okay, it's nothing. It's like body is neutral, energy is neutral. It's used to set up this play of loss. First there's gain. There can't be loss without gain, right? So first there's this construct of gain, and then that's swept away. First you build the houses on the ocean, on the beach, and then the tsunami comes in and the houses are gone. First you build a civilization, then you collapse the civilization. First you build up a population on a planet, and then you decimate the population of a planet. First you build up your health, and then you get sick and lose your health. That's how existence works. That's how energy works. It simply serves, is a symbol of essence, energy, and it serves the purpose of producing this mirage, this illusion of loss. And the best that energy can ever be is simply realize it's nothing. It's neutral. It's nothing. And energy itself is not what you really want. It can never give you what you really want. Essence, or the reflection of essence, is the halfway house to that. But the reflection of essence, it comes from unconditional love. And unconditional love is not an energy. It's more like a presence. It is a presence. Because it is change to it. It's equally distributed everywhere, and there's no change taking place. So it's like a presence that is everywhere. A still presence. And that reflects to us what we really want. So we really want this reflection. And we eventually realize that even more so, we really want to even go beyond the reflection, which we will do. Automatically at some point we'll say, okay, we're ready to go beyond the reflection even of what we really want. So we might I guess, you know, the best way to put it is that right now, where we're at, we need to assert that we really want a reflection of what we really want. Okay, that's valid. That is valid. Because that gives us continuity. Because the reflection is able to overlay everything, is overlaid, as it were. And so everything still can be familiar to us. It's overlaid with His presence. So we really want a reflection of what we really want. A true reflection that accurately reflects what we really want. So it's a perfect mirror. Unconditional love is a perfect mirror of what we really want. So that's what we want. We really want a reflection of what we really want. And if we can go there like that, then that's perfect. So let us understand what our goal is right now. When I'm talking about escape velocity from this part one, talked about the fact that this planet is under incredible siege. More than that, is under invasion from the etheric parasites, the etheric vampires, the psychic reptilian vampires of the etheric and lower astral realms, as it were, using humanity, stimulating humanity in certain ways to, like a generator that generates effects in the etheric and lower astral realms that enable those realms to somehow maintain some sort of balance or equilibrium and keep from decaying or falling apart, as it were. In order to escape this tyranny, this horrible tyranny, it's the worst kind of tyranny, because it seems like a soft tyranny, you know, like a gentle, you know, velvet glove tyranny. And we think, oh, you know, we got our wonderful sofa, we have this big room, we got our home theater set up, we got surround speakers, we got this, you know, huge screen, we've got 1,000 channels, we got everything on demand, and we got more coming on all the time, and we got this, you know, all we do, you know, we've got the remote controls, everything we want, we've got our all our great food and wine, and here we are, evening of entertainment, how fortunate, how advanced we are, we're in the paradise, you know, click, click, and here are these, like, robots, you know, with, you know, all these going at you, and they're coming at you, you know, and they're whack, 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 and they're whacking each other, and they're fighting, there's this terrible war, everything's getting hacked to pieces, you know, and you're like, and, you know, drink your wine, eat your food, you know, and of course everybody wants to add to that drugs, you know, smoke your pot, take your drugs, and just like that. And we think that's paradise. We think we've made it. we're made, you know, we finally made it. Come a long way, baby. Yeah, right. Yeah. Wasn't that like cigarette ads? That it showed the females here, the feminine form here, smoking. Like, what was it? What cigarette brand was that? I don't know. Cool or something like that. And they said, you've come a long way, baby. You know, look at this. You're liberated. You can smoke. This whole liberation thing is a scam. We're told that we're being liberated from the tyranny of religion, you know, austerity, you know, these religious people, you know, they're just sitting in some, you know, mediocre place, and they don't got the big screen, and, you know, they don't have the good, the Hollywood programming, you know, they're reading their Bible, or, you know, they're clinging to their Bible, and they're, you know, what sorry, sad lives those poor people live. Pity them, you know, but we've come a long way, baby, and we're liberated, and here we are. We got all these channels. We get to choose anything we want, you know. We can just indulge in this. We got, like, you know, anything we want. We want, like, vicious, full-on bodies being blown to pieces, you know, some warfare. Here you go. Click on that. You want some drama, terror drama. Click on that. you want some sob sister thing of someone being victimized. They got a million channels. You can watch any kind of victimization you want. You want pornography? They've got 1,000 channels of that. Of any kind of depravity you want. Any kind of depravity you want is just a click away, boom. And then you can even have picture in picture, you know. And you got multiple sets. And you go around the house and you can even move your screen outdoors now and watch whatever you want. And say, yeah, we've got it made now. We really got it made. Yeah, come a long way, baby. You might say we've fallen a long way, baby. Okay, is the right way to put it. We've fallen a long, long ways. And we truly have. What absolute insanity, what absolute stupidity. Embracing insanity is really embracing stupidity. As if, you know, we're like, as if those who are wiser are like, you know, thinking, oh, we're really stupid now. You know, no, not at all. So many people see through this. So many people see through it. And so many do not see through it. And that phrase, easy, so many do not see through it. Okay? So many do not see through it. Think about that. Think about that. Yeah. Physical culture, the body beautiful, worshiping the superheroes, the physical form, you know, worshiping the physical form. Very wicked thing. And then, of course, those who are producing all the stuff for you, you don't understand that it's an addiction. And what do those who have got you addicted do? They jack the price up. Okay? Not only that, they start asking favors of you. Okay? You know how addiction works. Very vicious sort of situation. At first you get addicted, everything seems fine, and then they say, you know what, I need you to sell some drugs for me, you know, that kind of thing. If you want to use that example. And I need for, you know, if the price goes up, then you need to start, you know, selling more and giving me, you know, what you got. You need to hook other people into the addiction. If you want your addiction to keep being fed, if you don't do that, cut off. You cut off. That is how addiction works. So as you get more and more addicted to this entertainment, this lifestyle, those who are producing this lifestyle will subliminally let you know, subliminally through psychic means, that you need to do some stuff for them, or else they're going to cut you off from this entertainment. They're going to quit. You know, they're going to stop. They'll say, hey, what they say is that their world's going to be destroyed, and they're going to be incapable of inspiring this entertainment. And if you don't keep producing more and more and being more and more stimulated by it, that their world will collapse and they won't be able to produce it for you anymore. And so you're addicted to it, and you say, oh my gosh, I can't live without it. So I say, okay, I'll do a little bit. And then you're led bit by bit by bit. You're led down the primrose path into atrocities. You know, they'll say, well, when you're watching these movies on your big screen home theater, you know, you need to be drinking some energy drinks, because you're not into it enough. You're not really into it enough. And you're going to sleep and you're zoning out, and we need you to be reacting to it, you know. Ah! You know, we need your heart to be pounding. We need your synapses to be firing. We need you to be freaking out. And you're not freaking out intensely enough for us, so you need to, you know. And so whatever way they're stimulating you, they say you need to do more. You need to get into it more. Okay? The terror stuff. You need to dress in costume. You need to get into character. You need to think that you're part of the movie and you yourself are being victimized and destroyed. You know? You need to identify with it more. You need to believe it's happening to you, that you're, and these robots are coming at you. Chomp, 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 chomp. You need to feel that you actually are there going to be torn apart. They want that realism. They want that virtual realism. They want you to get into that. Same thing with pornography. They want you to throw an orgy, You know, and everybody feel that, this, get into it, you know, live that, get into it completely. Whatever the stimulating trip they're putting you on to, they want you to keep getting into it more and more. They want you to hook more and more people into it and keep making it more and more intense. And eventually they're going to demand you start acting this out on the physical plane, which is you need to start actually carrying out these atrocities you're seeing on the screen. You start need to carry them out in this density, which is why you have these shooters, you know, that are taking place, because they're getting psychic. They're so addicted, and they're getting psychic demands of them that they need to do these things. That's what's happening, and that's what's going to happen to the entire culture. It's going to happen to the entire culture. Once you get them addicted that way, then the demands will escalate and escalate and escalate, and then they'll say, hey, you know, your reactions to these movies are not intense enough. Now we need you to go out and start acting out these things on other people in the world to create, you know, much more realism to it. And you need the shock and the horror and the decadence and all this wickedness. You know, you need to start living it, you know, and you need, so that's what happens. It's happened over and over in history. When any place where these psychic vampires, these etheric parasites are able to pull your dedication away from how to escape them, they then do this addiction escalation process. And we are now in, the reason why you have shootings every day is because you have this addiction escalation process, and eventually it spreads like a wildfire throughout the whole culture, and before you know it, everybody's at each other's throats, and everybody's behaving incredibly wickedly, decadently, different ways. Some are into violence, some are into sex, some are into victimization, some are into terror, you know, some are just into freaking out, some are into flipping out. You know, you know, some are just in, you know, and you start to see it in a culture. We've been seeing it. We're seeing red flags all the time in our culture now of, you know, terrible cannibalism, just stuff that is just off the charts. And you say, why do they flip out? You know, what is going on here? It's because this is all part of the entire process of these etheric vampires whose purpose is to stimulate us more and more and more, because never enough. It's never enough for them. It's never enough. They can never give what they want in existence. Existence can never give them what they really want. And so they just keep trying to get more of what they think they want. More control, more power, maintain their little bubble, you know. And so they, again, addiction escalation. That is how it works here. And that's why addiction is so doggone dangerous. So doggone dangerous. It's a slippery path. That's why the great Savior, you know, like Jesus said, hey, you know, you have to stay on the straight and narrow here. You got to work at it. You have to really, really live the life, live a religious life, meaning the life of dedication. Religion means dedication. That's all it really means. Religious people are dedicated people, dedicated to escaping these psychic vampires and all of existence, even, because existence is a self-annihilating hypothetical scenario of self-annihilation. And you have to be dedicated. Religious means, it means relentlessly dedicated. So those who are, you know, relentlessly dedicated are religious. Religiosity, dedication. Now, again, so we have to be dedicated to this. Otherwise, we will get pulled into some sort of addiction, and that addiction will be escalated. It happens to everybody. It's happened to me. It's happened to you. And you, before you know it, you say, oh my gosh, you know, these demands are being escalated, being made. And I think, well, okay, I'll just do it one time, and that should be, and they tell you, they always say, oh, just this one escalation is all that's needed, just this one. And then you say, well, I don't like doing it. I feel it's very wrong, but I don't want to be cut off from this addiction, so I'll just do this one escalation. And then you do the one, you know, and then everything gets more intense, and you think, okay, I fed my addiction, you know, and the addiction becomes more intense, and your responses are more intense, and then you feel you need more of that, and then they say, we'll cut you off if you don't do this one more, and it just goes on and on and on like that, and before you know it, you become depraved, you become willing to do anything. You know, people are doing stuff that is just, you know, off the charts. Off the charts. And nobody does that unless they feel they're going to be cut off from some addiction. Because if you have truth with you, you know, you can always turn to truth, you know. And if you have clarification, you can always turn to that. And you say, no, I don't need addiction to any of this stuff. I can turn to this clarification, this inner certainty. And that's what I really want. You see, I can turn to that. And so you don't go down the path so badly. It's still tough because you have to be dedicated. And you can be misled. And you can be deceived. And that's par for the course, which is why forgiveness is all important. Those who are truly religious are very forgiving. The most forgiving people on the planet by far and away. Because they know the score. And they know the addiction escalation situation. And they know that if you can, those who can break that cycle, you know, they'll come back to themselves, they'll come back to reason, they'll come back to dedication, and they'll be fabulous people. Every single one. When I see somebody who's down and out, I know that they are just as fabulous as the most fabulous person on this planet, really, except they're caught in this, you know, they're caught in this cycle. And they're stuck. They think they're wedded to insanity, they're wedded to impossibility, and that they don't feel the capability to get out of it. But guaranteed, if they get out of it, they will be absolutely fabulous. You know, absolutely fabulous. You see, anybody, you need to look at them that way. Try to look at them that way. You know. And treat them with respect, you know. I see these homeless people begging, you know, and I look at them, I treat them as an equal, with full respect, you know, and I just say, hey, there, but by the grace of God, go I, no doubt about it, easily. If I'm not, didn't get hooked up with, you know, the voice of reason and the grace of God and what didn't be dedicated to it, for sure I'd be there. Absolutely for sure, 100% for sure. You know, and any wickedness could have been led into any sort of wickedness whatsoever. Anybody can. Nobody is immune from that here. Nobody. So, forgiveness and more than that is respect. Respect, and call it love. You know, the Christians call it agape, which is a kind of informed respect. I call it. You know, you don't have to have an emotional love. No, it is a wise, informed, clear respect. But you know, that one is absolutely fabulous. What they really are is spirit, and they're, you know, immaculate, and they're caught up. They're temporarily being loyal to insanity, and they're caught up in these vicious cycles. And they you know, appear to be pulled down at this point, but they will break this cycle eventually. They will get out, and they will be, you know, absolutely magnificent. Everyone, without exception, even those psychic guides and the etheric vampires, the reptilians, and all everything that's going on. Same thing. They are just, you know, very wedded to insanity. Very wedded to insanity, and are trying to make the most of it. And they seem to be pathetic figures at this point, but still, you have to realize that they too will come out of it. They too will come out of it. And don't place yourself above anybody, but also don't place yourself below anybody. Okay? Do not place yourself below anyone. Okay, I've never done that. I've never said that I am lower than somebody else here. No way. Okay, no way. You are not lower than anybody. Everyone is equal, actually. Equally, completely magnificent. But there are differences in time. The differences depending on how addicted you are to insanity. There are differences there. So when we talk about higher and lower, we're talking a relative scale. Okay, so there is a relative scale. Definitely yes. But an absolute scale, there is no absolute scale because we're all equally magnificent in reality, equally free in reality, to play in reality. But there again, in the relative scale, there are great differences in time in this relative scale of addiction to insanity, and then all those, you know, the vicious circles of this addiction, you know, it's just horrible. And so one who is relatively free or understands the way to get free of it and helpful that way, relatively they're on a scale of more helpfulness, as it were. They're saving more time. So that's practical scale. They're, you know, on the higher and the helpfulness scale at this time, you see. So that has to be acknowledged. We can't just, you know, throw that out. You know, that's stupid. Because there, you know, obviously some are really badly trapped in this. What they don't see any way out, and they just keep doubling down on it. And they really need powerful witnessing to help them out. And others are very powerful witnesses. So they're, you know, that needs to be acknowledged and recognized. That's important. That's a relative scale. But we are still dealing with relative scales here. But you can also see things in the absolute too. You know, there is that feeling of absolute, like, hey, just because, like, I'm able to sit here and talk about stuff doesn't mean that I think I'm better than, greater than, you know, somehow better than anyone. No. I know that anybody else could do the same thing. And at some point they will. Because it's just they have to be very determined, very religious, as it were, super dedicated and determined, and they will eventually, to clarify enough so that it can, you know, you can actually talk about this stuff, because it's pretty heavy stuff. It's not, I don't feel it's heavy for me, but at one time it was heavy, for sure. Very heavy. I mean, you can get into some heavy places easily in this world. Too heavy. And my gosh. So, you know, don't, when you see somebody who's trapped, don't side with their futility. You know, don't look with them with pity, as it were. Give them that look like, hey, you're equal to me. I know you are. I'm positive of it. You're not really trapped at all. You're magnificent. Give them that feeling, you know, of respect. You're absolutely magnificent. Equal to the most magnificent, you know, of all. Everyone is. And don't side with their insanity, you know. Don't side with this futility that they can't get out. I mean, they're pursuing futility, and they feel they have to pursue it. So, of course, they feel futile. And you have to show them that, no, you don't have to pursue futility. It's a lie that you have to pursue it. You know, but these all these defenses make us feel like if we don't pursue it, we're going to be annihilated. So, you know, they're so hopeless, you know, hopeless. They just feel hopeless. And you don't side with their hopelessness. And don't side with the belief that the way is to succeed in changing reality either. You know, can't side with either one of those. Just side with the inner strength you know is there for them. Stay within that. Witness to it, otherwise they'll feel even more hopeless. Witness to it that there is this inner strength that you can access. There is this inner strength. Yeah. And there is this voice of reason within them. And, you know, that's the whole idea that has been built up through charity. Spiritual charity is to make sure that people realize that there is a way to get free of these vicious cycles. It's almost like a lost art here. Like Christian Science, you know, approached it from the standpoint of sickness, and they would acknowledge that someone believed that they could become sick, and the body's acting that out. But in truth, what is real cannot become sick at all. And so the sickness is just an illusion. It's just an appearance, but it's not based on any facts. So you can go into this very dark, you know, state like this. A very sick state, But the truth is, it's just in your imagination. It's not real. So the Christian Science approach the whole area of sickness and healing from really the right approach, really the right approach. And that was their particular approach. You know, I don't approach it through sickness and that type of thing. I recognized that that approach was very, very helpful. Very helpful. And of course, not everybody understood it, and maybe, you know, there are people who have took it too far in certain ways, and et cetera, et cetera. That doesn't invalidate the basic principles there. So you hate the sin, love the sinner, as it were. And you know for sure they're going to get out of it. For sure they're going to get out of it. 100% for sure. And for sure, their luster has not been lost. No matter what, no matter how wretched someone is, their luster has not been lost. Their true luster has not been tainted the slightest bit. But how many of us can witness that way in this world? That is the question, my gosh. We need more of those, I tell you that, who really can see it and know it. I have a few teachers that you know, that's the way they were. That's the way they always will be, is they see you as you really are. And they know you've not lost any luster. You have not lost any luster. It's impossible to lose luster. And of course, those who are acting out with bodies saying, look at all the luster I've lost. You know, they're really trying to convince themselves and you that it's possible to change reality. You know, that is really the truth. So you have to smile and realize they're pretending. They're playing a cat and mouse game of pretend, really. Along with the fact that there's these horrible addictions that they're caught in those, you know. So it's all a package deal. Delusion is a package deal. It looks like we did another hour, huh? What should I do? I guess we can end it here. It's a good place to end it, right? This is the second hour of our prime time pilot test here on August 9th. Not a moment too soon, because it's go time. It's moving time. And we gotta get moving on escape velocity. All right. Perhaps I'll do another one. Let's see if I can do another one. This is, let me get this posted for you. This is part two. All right, very great. That's it.